that. So it seems a bit odd that we're still paying the same amount. And would it be fair to say that you describe them as the Gove deals? I don't know, there's been future schools, there's been all sorts of things gone on over this period. That the lesson was, or the lesson is, that we, you know, we shouldn't have done the all embracing overarching thing of including FM and catering and all that sort of stuff. If, you know, it was done for the building and then you move on. But we've been left with that risk that the school closes and we have to pay a load of FM costs that the company isn't incurring.
I think two good points there. I think in terms of the first one, we are seeking to negotiate reductions with the PFI company. It gives you some idea of the negotiations that we're still not concluded. We will secure some reduction in the charges that are being made. We have spent a very long time, and Mary is very robust with us in meticulous detail. The workbooks that they produced are really great big thick things. And I don't think they've been there before, and we haven't been there before. But yes, I'm 100% confident we will achieve some reduction in the annual payment. The reason I haven't
Brits have now told me, let's have a word with lawyers, because when these things break up, invariably everyone goes straight to the contract. And if you haven't defined your requirements, then you can be absolutely hammered on the contract. And I suppose one of the bits of assurance I would find useful, I encourage you to find useful, in terms of the sorts of contracts we enter into now around this school buildings, etc., David, that we are somewhat less naive than when we go into these, believing that the contractor knows best and we're just a local authority, public sector, we don't know what we're doing, and blah, 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 blah. But we're actually more mature around that when we're putting contracts in. So when things go wrong, it's not the poor old council taxpayer who has to pick up the charge every time. Is that, would I be right in that assertion? Can you give me some assurance around that, Brad?
Going back to 2001, when the contract went wrong, actually, I think it's not thought that we were really ruthless in the way we dealt with the contractor. Each school went through a lot of pain on the ground, but they actually didn't make payments for a very sustained period. I can remember that I committed also at one point about £600,000 of additional expenditure, things like taking children off site for activities, things like accessing specialist spaces, workshops and things elsewhere. We recovered all of that from the contractor. The schools had a lengthy period of not making payments, which they then were able to invest later on. I think clearly PFI has changed nationally. I can't see the council entering into further PFI deals than the one that was done in 2001. PFI has changed. I think the reasons I outlined earlier, the two other schemes were better for the schools because they've got more flexibility. So I think it was a point in time. I'm not aware of any other contracts we've got that have those characteristics. If I was defending it, the teacher in me would say, if we had to replace all those mobiles over time, we'd have had to borrow all the capital, we'd have probably done it in a more fragmented way. But we did get the buildings finished and we got the young people in them. As I say, full cohorts have gone through, and it must have helped them with the specialist accommodation, the sports halls, the IT, the science and everything else. And it must have addressed some issues which wouldn't be acceptable now. I'm not defending the PFI system, but I think it was a point in time. We don't have any other contracts that I know. Because we've got a lot of space now, still at primary and secondary, we only receive modest capital grants, which is quite right because we don't need big capital grants, we've got a booming population. So the big schemes, there's no massive schemes going on at the moment.
Alright, so on the bright side, I'm not going to enter into another contract. I think we said at the very outset, there's no question of the quality of accommodations is a lot better. But we have been left with this potential £20 million risk that we're going to give us the figures because the way the contract is written, it seems to, in this particular area, it seems to be in favour of the contract, but we're not going to do any more. So, okay. David, Chloe, thank you very much for coming and talking to us about that. It's been very interesting. Okay, let's move on then. Now go back to the original. Go back to the original order. And the next thing I've got now is internal update. But before I do that, Stuart mentioned to me on the way in. So just want to pick up as an item of AOB the email we all received about member staff self-isolating. The coronavirus of member staff, and I think Stuart has got just some questions he wants to ask around that. We'll do that at the end of that.
Yeah.
Is that all right? Lovely. Okay. Like to be listening, Chair Stuart, as you might know. So, internal audit update. Mark.
Thank you, Chair. This is a regular report that I present to members of this committee. It contains information related to the delivery of the internal audit service. This particular period covers the 1st of January through the 21st of February. The report concentrates on identifying items of note, items escalated that require attention or action by yourselves, provide performance relating to the delivery of the internal audit service.
is that what it says it is, i.e. from the work that you've conducted between yourselves and the cabinet office and whoever, during this work you have identified £751,000 claimed when it shouldn't have been, or that paid when it shouldn't have been?
Yeah, that figure is correct. However, the caveat to that is that there's a figure within that of £531,360 identified at 3.38 that relates to housing waiting list. Cabinet Office have, I'll wind it back a little bit here. For the first time this year, during this exercise, this National Fraud Initiative, the Cabinet Office have undertook matches that involve councils' waiting lists around the country. So it's the first time we've done this. For Wirral, the match identified potentially 600 errors, frauds on the waiting list. Our waiting list currently runs to 8,251 individuals. Now, the council has investigated in conjunction with ourselves and found that of the 609 potential frauds that the Cabinet Office alerted to, frauds, overpayments, errors, combination, 161 of those have been identified by us as being incorrect for a variety of different reasons. Those reasons might be that individuals, when placing themselves on the waiting list, like their circumstances at the time were correct. They may have moved out of the borough, their circumstances may have changed, and they've neglected to notify the council of those changing circumstances. But at the moment, that 164 individuals equates to it's a notional figure that the Cabinet Office have applied to those 164. They estimate that the cost of providing temporary accommodation for those 164 individuals or all the people that are on the waiting list that have been bumped as a result of those 164 that shouldn't be there, and it equates to, as I say, £3,240 per individual with a total figure of £531,360. These aren't payments that have been made by the council. This is a figure that, as I say, it is a sort of notional figure that's been applied up and down the country to all the councils, being our total figure for potential error, fraud, and overpayment to £751,000.
So it's a course of
We're looking at £220,000 that we're actively going to pursue and that we feel are incorrect, either through fraud, through error, or through incorrect information we provide to the claimant. So there's a £220,000 there that we're actively pursuing. £531,000, as I mentioned, isn't actual payments by the council. So not something that we could go away and pursue. It's a potential for payments to have been made that we haven't, so we can't recover that money effectively.
Okay. Before we go on, okay. I told you one girl, there's bound to be questions. You haven't finished the work yet, have you?
No, very much. The work is due for the Cabinet Office don't require us to complete this work until the 31st of March, so it's very much still a work in progress. You'd ask for a snapshot of updates at this precise moment in time. We certainly plan to come back with a more comprehensive report at the next committee meeting, which will identify the exact nature of the errors and frauds, the amounts associated with each of those.
And how we're going to stop them in the future.
Just as importantly, if not more importantly, you're quite right, what action we will take to prevent a recurrence of the
crime. Good man. I think Stuart, we mentioned housing list, and we have Stuart.
I also find the language a bit disappointing, because if there's fraud, and the evidence of fraud, I'd expect that proper procedures, proper policy to be informed. So, if these are errors and expected, and the recruitment systems put in place to stop that in the first place. I've found it disappointing that errors, things, runs in the same senses as the word fraud, because an error or no payment's not fraud. Fraud is the criminal act. I would expect that any criminal act is dealt with involved with the Buckland Forest.
Good. So, you want to prosecute anyone? Yeah, good. Okay.
Can I just hold on to the closing? Yeah. The language used is the language that's provided by the accounts officer. We have no categorisation. Is again just like the sort of dialogue that we've had with them and their categorisation that have been used having counted in the country. So we'll not make any exceptions here. In terms of the actual the actions taken, as the chair quite well put out there, there will be actions taken to prevent, to sort of try and prevent an occurrence of this. If there's any identification of a fraudulent act having taken place, then there are channels that will be served on and that there are actions that will be taken in response to that are well established. Can't be talk specifics in this kind of open environment. I also can't be talk too specifically because, as I mentioned earlier, it's very much a process. We still have some sort of time to respect this.
Okay. Yep.
Can I
Okay.
I also would like to draw your attention to a piece of work that we've recently undertaken on the Wirral Health and Care Commissioning. It's a collapsed piece of work with colleagues from the Mersey Internal Audit Agency who provide the internal audit services to the NHS. This particular piece of work, like I identified a number of areas for improvements and development of a range of actions to improve this in the management. Giving you a flavour of those actions that have been taken. So there are a number of actions covering the finance, governance and risk management processes and procedures in place. And we intend to go back and follow that work with more work with some nature in collaboration with the colleagues from St. Mersey in 2018. I'd also draw your attention to 2.3, a piece of work undertaken on the procurement rules and test and evaluate the trust company operation within the governance approval documentation system. The audit findings identified again a number of areas for improvement as indicated and various actions were agreed with management to address them. The follow-up will take place and again you'll get indication of sort of what actions have been taken or we'll be able to report back in July.
I'm a bit surprised that we've still given the emphasis that we've had on procurement. Certainly we as a committee have had on procurement. I'm surprised to find that nobody's sorted that out themselves. So it's taken the internal auditors to come in and find issues to go on to.
Yeah.
I mean, at some point do we think the council is going to start taking procurement, its procurement rules and procedures seriously, do we think? Is it chance left?
I think it is, Keith will be talking to you later. There's a set of proposals on the
screen.
So he will have a line to use some of the good measures that have been taken. There's a lot of training taking place, there's a lot of targeted work being taken. So there is very much a sort of a move to address some of the line issues and then to sort of get decent proposals in place. But there's a little bit of way to go here, yeah, don't get me wrong. And this is just another example of the fact that you're quite right in what you say, and there's a work to be done.
Okay.
Can I also draw your attention to 2.4, piece of work that we've undertaken on the, not work as such, but it's the development of a programme of internal work for 2020-22 to test and evaluate the effectiveness of the Wirral Growth Company, looking at sort of key governance, finance and risk management systems in operation. The plan is in the sort of final stages. We'll be taking that to the Wirral Growth Company board and sales for an evaluation and feedback from, and then we'll continue to undertake a number of targeted pieces of work throughout the year again before we report back to this committee, so you'll have a role in receiving assurances from us that controls are either in place and working effectively or not in the case of things.
Well, that's good news as well as this recollection. Adrian, didn't we have earlier was on a quite an argument here, like, can't remember who it was, they were saying, no, council, because it's a separate company, we have no role in terms of auditing the books and all that, even though it was a separate company.
section 3.4 on page 13, I draw members' attention to the attachment to the report that summarises all the internal activity over what has affected the airline in quite a short period of time, not given the last meeting, which was in January, but it identifies the opinion provided and provides a brand rating in relation to the current status for those other reports and the progress that's been made by officers to address the issues identified.
Do we all remember what the brand rating got? Do you want to take us through the brand ratings again, just to remind in case somebody hasn't looked at them?
Blue is effectively everything.
Mine's all in black and white, by the way.
Oh, right. Okay. And you should have a letter in character there to identify whether it's blue and white.
Right.
I mean, the blue indicates that everything has been completed to time scale. The green indicates that significant progress has been made and we're smitten away from it being blue. Amber just indicates that recommendations have been green and are very much in progress. And then you drop to the red flag issues.
Yeah. Get that. I think that was up to the organisational risk report.
The opinions,
So your team's opinion has provided following the work you've done.
Now there is a key to that on the last page of the report.
In case people haven't.
Okay, dokie.
Don't keep that on the front of the mind.
Okay, no problem at all. Give me a second. So the organisation risk opinions, the major red flag items are those where there's a major opinion indicating that the likelihood or impact of the risk identified during the review should they materialise would leave the council open to an issue of a fundamental or material nature. This opinion suggests that there are some potentially serious weaknesses in the design and or operation of the control environment and may have a significant impact on the intuitive system.
We've got no majors here, I can see.
A moderate opinion is...
You've got one, two, three...
Yeah, a moderate risk opinion is indicated that the likelihood impact of risk identified during the review should materialise would leave the council open to a moderate risk or a fundamental material nature. The opinion suggests that there are some weaknesses in the design and or operation of the control environment that may have varying degrees of impact on the achievement of the systems and or corporate objectives. It's a step down clearly from the red flag major. And then we drop to minor, which is where there's a fairly minor risk opinion indicating that likely impact would leave the council at a very much minor risk. And then finally we have the negligible opinion on it, where effectively pretty much given the review of the indoor health.
So at the moment then, from the work that you've done, there is negligible is okay, minor is okay, moderate and
major and moderate.
Major suggests that we have some issues. Uh-huh. Looking at this, we have the third worst out of four. Performance management, business planning, rural health care and commissioning, rural evolutions and she's asked a few questions about the evolutions, actually, for your members. And Prad forms, all at the lower end of having a clean bill of health. So what, do we know what work's been going on about those?
Yeah, if you look to the rugby status, that indicates the progress that's been made by officers at the time. You'll see that the moderates as identified are all, if I'm not mistaken, either amber or rated. Amber rated at the moment, which indicates that recommendations have been agreed and accepted, timescales would apply to those implementations, and that the officers are working away. We will be following up to this within a 6-month period, again, reporting back by this kind of mechanism, so you will see, hopefully, those rank status ratings change.
you're telling us something's being done about it, so kind of don't worry about it type thing, because it's all take your word for us. How it's being done.
No, no, yeah.
So at some point when you report back in terms of the recommendation, we will know the recommendations you made, what's been done. There's, if you look at Wirral evolutions, everything else is following report issue, recommendations agreed, and action plan completed. When you look at Wirral evolutions, which had moderate, which was probably a more serious one, so it just says reports issued and advice given. Does that mean they haven't accepted the recommendations, or you didn't make recommendations?
The amber rugby rating indicates that they've accepted the recommendations and they're working on the mine. Maybe I need to include a bit more analysis.
Well, it's just you're
right. Yeah. This is a report that spat out a very stretchy that we maintain in the office, a performance spreadsheet which identifies and is populated by individual auditors. Once they complete the audit and they're engaged in dialogue with the client, they update that spreadsheet. So trying to get this consistent approach sometimes can be a little difficult. I can address that. I'll make sure it's got full visibility.
Okay, cool, thank you.
Okay, moving on then, section 3.5, identify information relating to the performance of the internal service. You'll note that delivery of the plan is on target for the first year end, and feedback from clients remains good, and that all the recommendations that we make, you see from that sort of performance indicator, are accepted by the clients. If that starts to drop off, that's when we should start to be considering this other than a new member of this committee. But I would be bringing that to your attention. I would be flagging that up for action. Section 2.6, page 14 of the report identifies some of the continuing improvements that have been made to the delivery service. I provide this as a regular feature really just to demonstrate that we don't kind of take back and that's our constant challenge and improve what we do and how we do it. I'd like members to note the report and if there are any questions, then I'm more than happy to.
Okay, happy to note that report. Any questions? No? Okay, lovely. Well done, Mark, as always. And as this is the last committee, can I ask you to pass on the committee's thanks to your team for the work they've done throughout the year? They are absolutely key to us making sure that we've got the right processes in place. And as we're going to find out in a few minutes, compliance is key. We have policies and procedures, they act as our controls. The work the team has done has been absolutely key in monitoring those controls. And my sense of it, given the conversations I've had, I think the chief executive is very key that we have a robust internal audit function and that recommendations are taken on board, and that those controls that we have in place are appropriate, are work, and are being applied. So I think you have a real, as well as this committee, I think you have a real champion in terms of the chief executive. So I'm glad he's got the same level of confidence in your team, you and your team, as I have. So thank you very much for the work you're doing. If you could pass our thanks on, that would be super. Okay, so the next item we've got here is internal audit annual plan. Is that right?
That's correct, yeah.
Okay.
This report presents the internal audit's annual plan of work for 2020-21. I'll give you an explanation of how it was prepared and identifies a list of proposed areas of the stage to be audited during 2021. Main points to note, I would say, are that we operate on a 12-monthly planning cycle in line with current professional best practice. This ensures that audit effort is utilised as efficiently and effectively as possible to mitigate risks in what is a very kind of dynamic and changing environment. The current public sector audit plan needs to be flexible, needs to be dynamic, we need to be able to react and respond to change.
So, in terms of the value that we get for that money, whether if there is a national audit picture, national audit universe, about what are the key risks local governments are facing, because you go into a lot of different authorities and you'll have conversations at a different level than Mark gets to have, that you have that, and that that feeds into, you know, some of the areas that we, as a, an audit committee, or certainly when we're doing work in internal audit is being carried out, that the things that we need to receive that assurance about. And Stuart, you'll remember this from Magenta, frankly, that the external auditors used to come and they would give us that discussion around some of those key, or key risks and areas that we need to be keeping an eye on. So I just wonder, for the vast amount of money we pay you, which is not more than we pay to them in other places, do we get that service?
Yes, we do provide you with progress reports of key issues going on in local government and in the public sector throughout the period.
Right.
Today we brought our external audit plan. The next meeting will be the, what the key issues are in the area as well, in the environment as well.
Okay, so what do we need to make sure next time then? Because you always tend to pop up last minute, you know, everyone just wants to go home to do it. So, are we going to build some time in? Because I think